Today I'm going to talk about something new and different. One of the users that's a patron asked me if I could cover the FiSec Spider version 1.1. So today we're going to talk about it, and in the future tutorials I'll talk about it in greater detail. So this board is able to do 8 steppers and has a processor of 180 megahertz for an STM32F446. And that's the processor right here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about the board real quick and explain the basics on how to use it. So first of all, we have our power. So you can do between 12 and 24 volts on this board, and this is the in power. Then we have actual power for the actual heat bed right here. Then we have an out power right here, and then we have 3 extruders that we can do right here. Then we have obviously our extruders that you can see right here, and you have your Y stepper, your Z stepper, which has 2 inputs for either 1 stepper or 2 steppers. Then we have our first extruder, our second extruder, our third extruder, our fourth extruder, and our fifth extruder. And then we have obviously our end stops over here. And part of the reason that I'm talking about the end stops is that you can do sensorless homing with these pins down here. So that means you can work with either TMC type steppers for sensorless homing, or you can do step dir for the types. And the types of TMC configurations that you can do for these steppers would be either a SPI or UART. Then over here we actually have some power pins that are derived from the power supply that you would use over here. So it's either going to be 12 or 24 volts. And then we have the same thing down here. Over in here we have 3 controllable fans that you can either do 12, 5, or 24 volts for power. And those can be controlled via signal pins. Over here we have our thermistor controllers, so we have our heat bed, which has 2 pins, and then each one of our extruders, being of the 3, you can do either 2 pins or you can do a 3rd pin that's powered. So I marked it in red over here, just like I marked red for voltage over here, so you know which is which. Down in here, I spoke earlier about end stops. So if you have mechanical end stops, remember the top row pins are not aligned the same as the bottom row. So keep that in mind so that you don't accidentally damage something. Then just below here, we have the BL touch or 3D touch pins that you can use. And apparently you can control the power that goes to them with the jumper over here. Now there's a jumper up here as well that allows you direct power, which it's currently on. That means it runs off PSU power or power supply unit power. And then there's a jumper up here that if you jump the top 2 pins will allow you to have USB power. Now keep in mind you don't want to use that when you're using TMC type steppers, as it'll reset the steppers. Then we have some control pins up here for a Raspberry Pi and also UART. And then we have our SWD pins, which are usually factory pins. Then over in here, we have pins that we can use for lighting on the actual board. So there's an RGB that you can see right there. We also have another set of pins down here that do a similar thing as well. And then we have our EXP 1 and 2 for display. Now the other pins I'll cover in greater detail later on, but just remember there's some pins over here that you can use for your actual SD card that are, I believe, broken out right here. And you have the same thing that's occurring right here with your USB connection. So what I'm going to do now is I'm actually going to show you the actual diagram for the board. Now, the reason I'm going to show you this is so that you understand how the configuration works. So up here on the desktop, we actually have the FISEC wiki. So it talks about the board, gives you a brief introduction, letting you know that you can do UART SPI, and you can also do CAN bus, as well as, I believe, SUART on this board. And so there's actually 8 different fans that you can do, but that'll be a tutorial in itself because there's many different ways to do that. Now, obviously, it talks about the NeoPixel and other types of RGB configurations that you can work with on 5 volts. So what we're going to do now is actually load the firmware. And just as of about 12 hours ago, a new firmware was posted. So we're going to have to download that real quick. And if you want more information about the firmware, you can always go to release notes. Now, apparently they're not very clear on their release notes presently, so there's not going to be a lot of information, but they do talk about issues that they fixed. So what we're going to do now is we're actually going to go first unzip the firmware we just pulled down by going to extract, and then we're going to click on the extract for the actual configuration. So while that's working away, we'll go back over to the browser and we'll look at the actual wiki that they have up on GitHub. So they talk about some of the configurations here and where the pinouts are. That's a very important thing that you'll need to check out. And then they talk about the board a little, and they show you the pins and what you'll need to use for which things. So over here, they have an actual enlargement of the board and what's connected to it. So as you can see, there are lots of motors, and then there's different configurations that they talk about for steppers, your display, integrating with Raspberry Pi, and of course, end stops over in here, fans, and then additional fans. So what we're going to do right now is we're actually going to go over to VS Code. Now, I've already downloaded this and installed it with Platform.io, but I will post a link to the install tutorial on this so that you understand how to install it correctly. But since the file is finally extracted, we're going to click on Explorer, then Open. Then we're going to go over to our Downloads folder, our Marlin folder, our next Marlin folder, and then Select Folder. So inside here, what you're going to see is the platform.io.ini and the default environment. Currently, it's set to the chipset for the Mega 2560. But what we're currently using is actually the STM32F446, which means that we're going to have to go to the INI folder. And then we're going to have to find our INI, which is probably going to be STM32F.ini. But we can confirm that by first going to the Marlin folder, then the source folder, then the core folder, then boards.h. Inside here, we're going to search on Spider. And as you can see, here is our board. So I'm going to copy the motherboard for that, and you can see that the chipset is STM32F446. So now that we know that, what we're going to do is we're going to minimize this for a moment and source, go to configuration.h, and this is the basic configuration. So we're going to do a search on motherboard, then I'm going to paste it over the RAMPS configuration. And I'm going to change the serial port to -1. Otherwise, it will not work with the USB connection. So if your USB doesn't work, it's usually that this is not set. So now that we're configured, I'm not going to show you too much in here. I'll cover that in later tutorials because it's hours of information. So what we're going to do is we're going to set up the build real quick. So we're going to go back over to Platform.io. We're going to search on our default environment, which is in the INI file or folder. We'll click on the STM32F and we'll search on FISEC. And down here, it's a little confusing, but the one you want is the FISEC underscore S6 underscore 8000. So you're going to copy that, close out of this INI folder or file, pardon me. And you're gonna go back over to platformio.ini and you're gonna paste it over the Mega 2560. And that's our configuration. Now, there is gonna be a question of pins in the future. So I wanna cover this real quick. So if you go to the source folder, then to the pins folder, then find your chipset, which is the STM32F, you're gonna see that there's a spider in here. So as you can see, it's a FISEC spider, and it talks about some of the pins for the configuration being, in this case, steppers. And then additionally to that, it talks about, you know, the TMC for certain configurations, and then there's probably hot ends covered in here someplace. So right here, you have heaters and fans. These are actually your extruders that can also double as fans. Now, it doesn't show all the pins, and I'll show you how that mystery is solved. If you go over here, you'll see that there's an include for pins underscore FISEC underscore S6. That means you have to go to this file, and this will show you where the remainder of your pins for your configuration are stored. So it's important that you actually understand this, because this is basically the outline of all the pins around your board for your sensor pins or your analog pins. So now that I've covered that, what I want to talk about is actually how to build. Now, the easiest way to build that I prefer is first I go over and I check the .pio folder. And as you can see, there's a Mega 2560 that was built before they released. So to clean that out, we're going to click on the little garbage can down here, and that will empty out this folder. Now what we need to do is actually click on the checkbox for build. And the reason that I say that is because you can't do an upload directly to the board, even with a USB connection. Now there are ways to do it, which maybe someday I'll cover, but I want to show you the easiest and safest way to do it. So I'm going to click on the checkbox. Now if it fails on the first build, what you're going to have to do is probably do a second build with the checkbox. If it fails after the second time, find the very first red indication in here and fix that error. If you see other errors after that, it's usually a cascade of errors caused by the first. So you'll want to rebuild first and then find the very first error again. The yellow that you saw that just scrolled by, that was actually a warning. That's okay. So now that we look at the .pio folder and we see the FISEC S6, we're going to expand that out and our build will be right here being firmware.bin. So we're going to right click on that and reveal in File Explorer. So inside File Explorer, you see firmware.bin. So we're going to have to go back over to the desktop for a second, pop out the actual drive and place it inside this little converter unit for reading the SD card. Then we'll place this in the computer. You'll hear a beep. Then we'll go back over to the desktop. We'll examine the actual folder, which says old.bin. So their naming convention is different. It doesn't say firmware in all capital letters. And then .cur, it will say old.bin instead. So let's go back over here, right click, send this to the drive. And the drive that I'm using is actually an 8 gigabit SD card. So now we have this. If it loads correctly, it will rename itself to this and maintain the same date modified. So let's go back over to the workbench. We're gonna pop out the drive. We're then going to place the drive in here. And in order to power the board, we use a USB. Now, it won't power initially because of the jumper. So we'll pull this out and we'll move the jumper over, which is right here. and then we'll place it on the top two pins. Now we'll plug it in and the board will be powered. So this will flash the firmware. And what you need to keep in mind when it's flashing the firmware is that once it's complete, you're going to need to power cycle with the reset button over here and then let it power back up. Then what we'll do is we'll go over to Printerface on the desktop. So I'll bring this up, and inside Printerface, what you're going to have to do is connect to the board, and currently it's set to COM port 1. So to find the actual COM port, we'll go over to the desktop, we'll open up Device Manager, and inside Device Manager, we're going to expand it, and we'll see that there's a COM port 1, which is always default, and then COM port 6. So to set this up, what you can do is you can either click the drop down and see if it's there, or if it's not, you can click on this, backspace, say 6, then connect. So what you're seeing now is it's connected and printer is now online. So if you want to check things with G codes, an example of what you would do would be like M119, and this will check the end stops. Since none are connected, what we'll actually see is that the end stops will read triggered. So I'll press enter and see what happens. And as you can see, they're all triggered until we connect an end stop. Now, one of the things I do want to say is thank you to all the patrons and people that have been making donations on PayPal to make this possible. And what I'll do in the end of the tutorial is I'll place a thank you message so that you can see your name. If you don't see your name, let me know. And if you donate, it's a great way to show your name as a supporter. So I want to take a moment to thank everyone, and remember to like and subscribe, and take care and have a nice day.